The only thing that is guaranteed in life is death. Coping with tragedy is one of life's greatest enigmas. The human psyche is designed to mourn and to move on in stages. But what happens when the frail human soul is assaulted by death continuously and consecutively? Is it a generational curse? Are there sins coming home to roost? Can the cycle be broken with love and marriage? And if it does not, how can life go on when death is the only and most difficult certainty to overcome? The Prince of Darkness invaded the Untold Stories set to rearrange this documentary and left even me questioning the meaning and value of human life. Tonight, Untold Stories presents 5 Funerals and a Wedding.
Ad Movin was the first one, and Kevin the second, Murphy the third, and Neville the last. I had a girl. She had 5 days on earth. When I was about to have her, they tell me, well, my pressure went up. So I went to the hospital and they tell me, well, they have to take out the child. So I tell them I want my girl to live because that's the only girl I will have. A nurse come and she tell me, well, because I still had the anesthetic inside of me, so she tell me that she will take the child and she'll go and baby the child. Then after that, I see a long time I had not seen the nurse. So I said, let me go and see what the nurse do with my child. When I reached there, I find the nurse had the child naked. So I go, I take the baby, I put clothes on. It didn't take 5 minutes. I had the child on me. I feel the child coming so hot. So I tell her, I go to another nurse, I tell the nurse, but why the child so hot? I mean, the girl run back in the nursery with the child. So when I went back to the nursery, I see everybody come, they take the child, they start poking on the child, start doing things with the child. So I say, what's going on? Then the doctor come and they tell me, did you feed the child? I say, no, I never feed the child. So the doctor say, well, afterward they tell me, well, they feed the child and the milk went down to her lungs and give her pneumonia.
Growing up in Wilton's Yard was like growing up in Calabash State at the time, because there's a lot of children used to be playing around. It's nothing like it is now. Totally different. The changes came when different people start moving in. Different people move out, good people move out, left. And you find, well, other people came in that from other areas that, well, they thought was, they came into safe havens, but in their coming out from where they came from with their bad influence, bringing it into the Wilton's Yard. It has changed because a lot of young people there now, people that just come around, not even related to, a lot of them are not even related to the people that live or from the place. My daddy had us like, your sister and your brother is your friend. So when we pass, he's hi, hello, you know, that kind of thing. But no friends to go at friends' home, you don't know that. Well, David, then we have Beverly, then we had Afu, then we had Curtis, myself, Irvin, Ruth, Sharon, my sister that passed away last year, and my last little brother, Benton. We used to fight like every day and love each other every day in the same breath. You know, but the one thing I remember, Afu, before we started a fight, he would be the peacemaker. To come and say, but I am making no sense. What you're fighting for? But I am making no sense. So they were a peacemaker, you know. And we would just have that. We'd fight for everything, anything. You know, not really fight, but going to war. Like we have. That's how I got to learn how to defend myself, because I grew up with them, and they would always want to wrestle with me, you know. Especially the one after me, Irvin, and myself. We used to wrestle a lot. they used to instigate it, like most times. They would say, the girl could beat you, and he'd say, ah, oh, I don't, come with me. And then, you know, so he would go, would put something there, line, and tell me, touch it. And if I touch it, the soda would break and would fight. And he's such a loving brother of mine, and we always fight, and we always still make up right away, because you couldn't stay vexed in the house with daddy.
When I reach there, the nurse tell me, sit down, take a chair, sit down. I sit down. She tell me, hold the child on me. So I hold the child on me. When I look, I see the child is not shifting, the child, like, the child died already. Yeah, I sit down there and I sit down and I hold her. I hold her for a long while, and then my husband come. And then they tell us, Miss Darcy, your daughter passed away this morning, and that was it. I went to a funeral in the church, and the girl had the baby the same way. She had the baby had born, was born and died the same way. And I talk to her, I tell her, well, God help me, you know, and I give her strength. I tell her, well, she have to have strength, you know.
The peacemaker. Humble, loving, quiet, used to be sick a lot at his early stage, but very humble. If you, like two people going to fight or something going to happen, he would be the one seeing, he not seeing the reason. He'd be the lawyer, he'd be the judge, he'd want to be the, you know, putting it to rest. Don't go there, that don't need to be there. You don't need to fight, you don't need to get on, you don't need, that don't need it, that's not needed. Yao God, Chai is our guide, Gaster, you know, and he's, he would always have that strong feeling of faith within him. Afu was a self-employed person. He used to fix tires. He had his own tire shop at once. He would have gone on the farm if he have to, the same way. He's a juggler, you know. In other words, what he get, what he sell. What he have of his own, he sell. He would go out if he have to get, if his drugs he'll get, he'll sell, you know. That's who he was. I used to fight every day from school, and they used to be my defense. I think one time they fight with Charles Kosher, after Curtis, you know, and the two other guys, I think. And one time they came in the yard, and another guy came to the yard, attacked my brother, one of my brothers, in Darky or Afu. And then Darky was there, and Darky had to defend, and they made the guys run, you know. Because they used to go to the gardens and play football, cricket. So sometimes, you know, Conway and Wilton's yard at that time, always in a little beef. So that's where they always used to find themselves in a row.
His father had a really love of moving. His father used to take him to, you know, when he was born and things like that. That was, moving was goal for us. It took about like a year or so, and I had Kevin. The two of them was there like twins. But Kevin was smart, smarter than moving. When I give moving his passage money, he eat it. Afterwards, he eat it in the school to buy things with his friend. But Kevin would take his money, put it in his socks, take out his shoe, put it in his socks, and push back the shoe. And every time he go home, because when they start getting older, I listen to them go home by themselves, you know. And there's a young man, Mr. Ben, he tell me, that boy is a smart boy. Because every time I stop for him a bad day, I know I have to wait, because he have to take out his shoe, take out his socks, and take out the money inside of it. But Movin never have money, always eating it. Nobody wouldn't touch Kevin, brother. Kevin will fight. I have to go in the school because Kevin will fight. If you want to tell me, Movin is coward, but Kevin was not coward. Kevin will fight. If something happened, Kevin fighting. Movin will quarrel with Kevin now. 5 minutes, he'll call Kevin. Let's go and do that with me.
They shot at him the Sunday night. So the Monday morning, and I saw that hole in the vehicle, and I'm saying, Doggy, what happened there? So he like, guys, some boy trying. I said, Doggy, your head there, go for it. They wanted to kill you, my boy. And you tell me, God, such a child, I don't know what, I don't know for what. I find that so strange. I come from my country, I got somebody just open shut. But it's God that wrote me. I say, praise God, because God see it there for you. You hear me? And I say, dog, you have to pray and be careful when you go in there. Better you pack your car, and if you have to take a taxi and go there. Don't go there if your car for them to take you for it. Please, I can't afford to lose you. That was a Monday, not knowing the first day was down the line. The morning I got up, it was a usual morning, like always. I got up and went to the garden. He was underneath his car, fixing something in his car at the time. So I got up and I went to him. I said, like, we used to call each other doggy. So I'm like, doggy, what are you saying there? And he's like, hi there, my girl. I know I'm too that guy, so I just give me trouble. And I tired of that guy. I said, doggy, you don't know already. When he told his trouble, he's giving, doing the thing. What you can do, at least you don't have to pay a mechanic. See what you can do. So he tell me, yes, guys, but yesterday I finished working that and that gave me trouble. I remember him. Now I'm talking to you with his boxers, his hands dirty, he's patting his hands and he's trying to change. By the time I go up in the hills, he said, you're going up in the hills, Michael? I say, yeah. I left, not seeing any sign of anything. While I was in town later that day, he called me and he told me, Chero, tell him, it wasn't my husband, it was still my boyfriend. Tell BJ, I said, I'll check him later, I'll get him to get the thing for me. I don't know what it was, but I'll get him to get the thing for me. And that was the last I heard of him, I heard his voice. But I wasn't sleeping yet, but I was just relaxing, watching television about 9 o'clock when I got the phone call from a good friend of his where he was going and tell me, Cherry, they kill him. I'm like, they kill who? They kill him. Because he's the guy I saw. So I'm like, doggy, what happened? And she tell me, no, Cherry, they kill him, they kill him. So I tell her, who killed him? She said, I don't know, they kill him, they kill him. So I ask him, she said, that's Candia. So I said, okay, I come to ask her where she tell me by her who. I said, okay, I'll be there. So I told my husband. My husband heard me saying that at the time. He like, ooh, Cherry, what? And I tell him, Afu, Afu. And he said, that's not true, that's not true.
Why the person kill him so?
Members of the urban community of Wilton's Yard say they are stunned by the shooting death of 48-year-old Arthur Afu Clark. According to law enforcement, Clark died after he was shot multiple times Thursday night by assailants at Chase Gardens. His sister Cheryl Clark says her brother was a revered figure who kept the peace in the inner city neighborhood.
Afu is one of the quiet ones on the quiet side. One of the days when he was young, like all young guys would be doing whatever they want to do. But he grown out of that and I think he has took a stand where he know wrong cannot be right.
Close friends are baffled by his violent death.
When you look at the young people, right, killing people like Afu, you know, I have to ask myself where that stop the violence is going. He is the kind of person who would try his utmost best to stop it, and still they would kill it.
They called me. The girl called me. She told me, come up. Come now. You tell me your house on fire. But when I reach here, I thought I would find something. You know, but when I reach here, I only find the roof going down. I said, Lord, what am I going to do? How am I going to start again? I say, I don't know what to do. But people come and people help. You understand? I didn't know what to do. I didn't know where to turn. Because I tell you, that house had everything inside of it and I had spent a lot. All what I had on that house. But that night, I stepped by my mother-in-law. So that's where I stayed for a long while, by my mother-in-law. I stayed for a long while. And the sun and going to work, coming up there, people start bringing clothes for me, you know, and things like that. And I say, you know, I'm not going to, you know, I'm not going to kick myself down. I'm going to get back. And somebody, I always have faith in God. I say no. Then after that, the government come. The government send money for us to start. So we start with the flooring of the house. And then that one sent for me. You know, Alambi sent. People start helping me. I believe God gave me strength. I could be fit. When I reach and I see everything gone, I say, Lord, I finish. I finish. I say I finish, but God give me strength.
Knowing my brother, somebody that have saved so many people's life, and he didn't have anybody to save him. Because if a so-called shot was called on him, because like things like that, when he hear things that happen to people, he will go on in between and try to talk to others and tell them that not making sense, and you don't have no right to call a shot on a man because he owe you and these kind of things. You know, I come from. So if something was like that has that did on him, I feel they had to have somebody probably that could have told him, "Afu, watch yourself. Why did he kill my brother? Who killed my brother? What did my brother do for him to deserve that kind of death? Who killed him? For what?" And that's all I'm keep asking. God, give me strength. Yes, who killed him? And that's all I'm saying. And I got there and I seen all I could have done was scream. What we did as a family, we stayed together. Because at that time, you try to do things people have to say, because it is a situation that you have to deal with no matter what the consequences is. As a family, we learned and we grow to always, no matter what the problem, you stick together. Who vex, stay vex, but the problem have to be dealt with and we will solve it together. What people had to say, I tried to, didn't even want to hear. Because you know what? If you all knew so much, I'm happy that you all know and I don't know. Because I didn't see my brother in that manner, because I would say, okay, he's taking somebody money here, he took somebody this here. And I'm like, ah, fool, taking somebody this. That's not him.
I saw Kevin on Saturday. I saw him on Saturday, he came here. He was there with me. We went to town. We went and shop. You know, and I bought some stuff for him for the children, and because he was not working, I bought some stuff for him for the children. And he told me, well, his wife had given him something to do, a little bit of grocery too, so he did his grocery. He went up. When he was going home, I was waiting for my husband to come to him to go home. He didn't wait for me. He went up by himself. He told me he had to go, he had to go and do something. So he came up and then he was there the Saturday. The Sunday, I didn't see him. I get up and I go to church. I didn't see him. I didn't see Kevin. The Monday morning, I get up and I go to church. It was a whole day. I didn't see Kevin. Moving, I saw him. I saw Moving on Sunday. We sit down. Moving was sitting down right there. I was sitting lying down there and I tell him, Moving, let me tell you something. Because his girlfriend had just gone. I said, let me tell you something. You need to pray. You need to go to church. He told me, yes, mommy, I wanted to go to church, but I shall go. I said, no, you don't need Ashel to go to church. Get up and go to church, Moving. Get up, get something, do something. So we sit down there, we sit down the whole, we see, Moving maybe leave here this Sunday around after 10, 11, so, and then we go down to his home. The Monday, I didn't see him because I went to church early. So I didn't see him.
It was hard. Because you finally reach into the point where you know it's over. And no matter what, he'll never come back. To lose somebody such as Afu was like digging my heart out of my chest. Knowing he has been so humble, God-fearing, caring. To so many people, and imagine extending his family, he had loved each and everyone. I dress him, I grease his hair, comb it out, tie it on for him. So I had that chance with him alone, where I could have talked to his body. You know, and asking him why, what he did not tell me. Come and let me know, because I would like to know, because the way I feel about him, I cannot hear stories being told about him which I have no idea what it is. You know, and if I am praying, I want to pray that God will answer that prayer and let that person be brought to justice. The only way I think I'll really get closure with my brother's death, when whoever it is that saw it was fit to take his life, for whatever circumstances it was, money couldn't pay the price of my brother's life. God gave life. And when somebody take money on somebody's head to kill somebody for some money or some whatever it may be, which I don't know, I don't want to assume, but like I say, whatever it is, when that person is being brought to justice, I think that is when I will get the closure I need for my brother. Why did you kill my brother? What did he do to you? And I only hope you ask God to forgive you for taking an innocent man's life. Because God is not asleep, he's awake, and he will serve you.
A lady come, a girl from up there, she called me and tell me, Willena, you have to go. I said, we have to go away. He tell me, she didn't tell me it's my children. She tell me her son, they say her son drunk. So I tell, that day I bang my hand on the railing outside. I said, Lord, what them children gonna do by the beach? That's why I always tell them children not to go by the beach. But what comes to my mind is Neville. Because when I reach here, they will not go to church and they will go by the beach with them. So whilst we're going down, Rose get a call. She, I heard she say, oh, Kendall there? Oh, well, all right, Kendall there. Then I didn't see her, she said nothing about moving and curving. But I didn't take that for nothing. I said, stop, y'all making noise, stop making noise. Let's go by the beach to see what happened. Let's go first to see what happened. Stop making a noise. So we go down. When we reach almost by sandals, of our hair fellow say, they say Bugula honey, you know, like both of them get drunk already. I heard a fellow say that, but to me I didn't hear him say anything. It's long I go in. By the time the van stop had already go down the valley. I reach by the beach, I find they have people by the beach, and so I say, where's Neville? He said, no, Neville, look, Neville there. Samson was there, Neville was there. I scanned it, I found Kendall there. In tears, Kendall crying. I say, so he's moving on Kevin. I give a shout by the beach. I say, let me tell you something, the devil. You can take every bit of my family, but you cannot take my soul. You cannot take my soul, and I realize it's me you want, but you cannot take my soul. And I think, I don't know what I heard, like I heard somebody say, well, look, they find one. And I think that's the last thing I heard, because I had failed. Then I get up. When I get up, they say, but look one. I saw just like something come on the beach. And the wave just take it back again. When they say look one, I think everybody had to leave the beach. The sea roll up, I tell you, roll up on the sea, just bash on the hotel. Everybody had to run. So I say no going back there.
I was just sailing, and then that person woke up to me, asking what I have to sell, and I told him. So he said, I'm a level saltfish. Can I get a saltfish sandwich? Like, no problem. So he bought a saltfish sandwich, and I think at the time was a juice, a local juice. Then at that time, he like, I really like to see him. He said to me, I see my wife. I'm like, excuse me? Yes, I see my wife. I say, I think you're looking in the wrong corner. So he's like, I don't think so. And my heart tells me I'm the right place. But my son had really chose BJ for me, probably make me make up my mind. Because just as he jumped in the water, I wasn't in the water, I was out of the water, but my son was standing on that rock there, you know, and BJ was in the water. He's like, come, jump, because he's 5 years. So he jumped. Just as he jumped to BJ, he's like, yes, I have four daddies now. My son just fall in love with that man. Who is that man, guy? Like, they question myself. It happened, and we still remain friends with friends until, well, we got closer. And you know, he know how to charm a woman. You know how to get to a woman's heart. With the time we have been together, we had a lot of breakups and makeups. But I always see to love him because of the way he used to get to me. First 2 years, it was okay, like the first year and a half. Then we came and we had difficulties where he started doing drugs. His passage, and I sent him to Dominica. From Dominica, he went to Jamaica. And from there, when he came back, everything was okay with him. And we have been going on, you know, strong. Did some time in prison, trying to smuggle some drugs, you understand? He did 5 years. Then I realized, well, I had to wait for him.
Imagine being told that your loved one had been snatched away by raging sea waters. Now imagine that horror times two. And that is the reality of a family today as they hope and pray that the bodies of their loved ones will be found. The family of 34-year-old Kervin Darcy and 36-year-old Mervyn Darcy are keeping watch at the Latok beach, hoping that the huge waves which took their loved ones away will send their bodies back to shore. The wife of one of the men says the family is also yearning to be briefed on the status of the search effort.
My husband's last speeches was, he told me that he loved me, and when he come back, he'll cut the children. He was supposed to give the children a haircut for me. And he told me when he come back that he'll eat so much. That's all he said to me. And that was his last word, and I never seen from there.
Right now, they in the city, and I cannot find them. I cannot see them. Well, I really miss them. And we, from last night, we left there at least 6 o'clock or 6:30, so. And go home having that in my mind so much, I cannot sleep. 7 o'clock, come back here.
They don't know how never return show. They don't know how Neville returned show because Neville was going after Kevin. When he said the way was going, Kevin was going after Kevin. And Kevin tell him, Neville, go back. Go back, Neville, go back. And then he's go the way Kevin going down and coming back up, you understand? So they tell me, Neville, because I said Neville's training for swimming. They said Neville barely make it on shore. They don't know how Neville reach on shore.
Babes, today's your birthday, I can't get married. I'm like, no, tomorrow we're getting married, you're not supposed to know what's there. He said, I've missed you so long, I don't know what's there. I say, well, it's a special taste because you have to wait for that special day to walk up that aisle. Walk to watch him in his eyes. See, well, I'm going to spend the rest of my life with this man.
In token and pledge.
In token and pledge.
Of the vows between us made.
Of the vows between us made.
With this ring.
With this ring.
I thee wed.
I thee wed.
In the name of the Father.
In the name of the Father.
And of the Son.
And of the Son.
And of the Holy Spirit.
And of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
Amen.
Mm. journey of 1,000 miles begins and ends with you. The journey to my heart is you alone.
You're looking. He came with some ideas that he himself had to go through while he was in prison.
Yeah, well, we have a 14-team knockout competition with Baccara, La Panse, Leslieland, Rose Hill, Grass Street.
So he came with all the knowledge of getting down to implementing after-school programs that, you know, to change children's manner and ways. Then I introduced him to the Ministry of Social Transformation, where he had a good rapport with everybody there. Everybody had liked him because they liked his work, how he was working and influencing parents, children, to, you know, to attend that after-school program and whatever.
Well, that night, my mind was functioning all different kind of way. I was saying, Lord, how it happened? Sometimes I saying, well, how moving and curving is inside of there. I say, Lord, do something for me. As though, you know, just hoping that they will be back. Next day I will see them. I say, they say, well, they tell me then, curving is the one that was getting drunk and then moving went after him. So I said, well, when Kevin drink that water, how? Because I never drunk one, so I know how it is when you drink some water. I say, my God, when Kevin go down and go up and go back down, what? How he feel? Did he pray? Where his soul is going? You know, and I start thinking all different kind of way. I say, moving go down with Kevin, my God, but moving for the safe, because when we reached there, the man tell us he had moving. He had moving already. So he tell moving, chop curving, because curving already died. Chop curving, but moving, like he sees on curving, he was not dropping curving. So the boat capsized with the man. So we say when the boat capsized, so himself tried to go back on the, not a boat, the little thing there by the beach. He said that moving, when moving tried to grab him, you understand? Moving scratched all his arm down and moving went down. The man self was crying because you see, he had moving already. If moving had only listened to him, he would have saved moving.
On Wednesday, the body of Mervyn Darcy was found 300 yards off the coast of the Latok beach, sometime between 9 and 10 a.m.
We identified the body already. They opened the bag for us there. But the sea, the stone hit some of his body already. So I realized that's my son, and the next one's still missing out there. So God make us, and he taking us when he want, not us that do ourselves. So when God call on you, you have to go.
When I reached in the hospital, like, I didn't want to see moving, but I don't know what gave me the strength. I said, I want to see him. We stayed a long while and then they come. When they come, they open him. I see all moving hair. Like the locks was going, coming out, like, you know, something, take out the locks from his hair. I see, like, he gets some burn in his belly, his arm, his leg, his face. And I see, like, one of the eye, he don't have one eye. Like something was eating his eye already.
He jumped in the van. When he jumped, he turned back. He said, babes, I love you. I said, I love you more. Then he said, you don't love me more. I said, of course, I don't love you more because I didn't cheat you. I didn't do nothing wrong. I've been honest to you. You doing the wrong, so you don't love me, you know? So he's like, I'm missing you already, babes. I ain't even for the Mepui, but I'm missing you already. So I'm like, okay, fine. I'll see when I come to town, I'll call you, babes. He driving out and he going. He turned back, he stopped and he said, babes, I really missing you, eh? Because you don't give me some. I said, right. I love you too. And then he drive off.
And that was the last I saw him or heard him. Auntie, auntie, come fast. Come fast, come now. They kill him, they kill him. What did he do? Who did he do anything? What went wrong? What happened, Lord? What is my faith, Lord? Tell me, are you testing me? And I'm screaming, but that's going through my mind. And I'm like, God, thank you for whatever you put me through, but give me the strength to go through. Seeing that body lying ahead, but I saw the shoe. And from the shoe, I saw was my husband. And I could hear my daughter screaming. Could hear my daughter's voice. And she like, Papa, Papa, Papa. I felt like I was weak. Like there wasn't any life in me. But a voice would say to me, Jai, thank you every day. Stay high. Stand strong. Stand strong, don't fall. And I'm running now, I got that strength and I'm just running towards the body. And just as I was running, I think the policewoman came up to me and told me, you cannot go, I tell her I want to see my husband. And I'm going closer and trying to fight my way to just see him. And then the closer I got where I saw his hat and his shirt, I'm like, oh my God, it's really him. I just felt like I just dropped.
Asha Emmanuel, affectionately known as BJ, was said to be a well-respected resident from Wilton's Yard. On Tuesday, April 7th, just after 11 a.m., Emmanuel, who reportedly was near the Leslieland community, was the target of gunmen who opened fire.
BJ, as is affectionately known as, is not any man involved in any kind of violent conduct. He moves away from it. He speaks to those persons who have the general inclination to get involved. He's the kind of person who would ask you, let's go on my farm. Come and help me plant my crops, whatever, whatever. That is the kind of person that BJ is. BJ has never indulged in any kind of violent activity as far as I know, and for him to have met his demise in such a calculated, vicious manner is pathetic.
We're on the farm. He left me. Kissed me. Babes, I love you. When he left and he jumped in the vehicle, he turned, he was going, he said to me, babes, I'm missing you already. Babes, I'm missing you already. I said, babes, words. So he said, no, babes, for real, I'm missing you already. I'm going to come back as soon as I finish.
Many expect this brazen act may reignite a long-running and deadly turf war between Leslieland and Wilton's Yard factions. Clark, however, remains resolute in her condemnation of violence.
I'm sorry to say to Saint Lucians and whoever expecting the worst, the Almighty is not asleep. I strongly believe in him. I think I had more than one death to realize that with the Almighty, everything will be answered. He's the only one that have the answers. As far as violence is concerned on my side, like I will say again, the Almighty will do that.
The wife of the deceased has stern words for the alleged perpetrators still at large.
Too bad, I'm going to say to the young ones that did that, I'm so sorry that you let your life go astray when it could have been saved. I hope you can find it in your heart to see that you all did something wrong to somebody that did nothing to you all. That you all can only find it to give up yourself.
We can have hope after death. We can have hope even whilst we are alive. There is hope. There is comfort. There is assurance.
Let it all out. These are the things I can do without. do without. Come on, I'm talking to you. Come on.
When I went up to sign, I burst in tears because I know I will not see my children again.
The Christ who called you, take you to himself. The angels lead you to the bosom of Abraham.
When I was in the cemetery, when they were going to bury him, that's the time I started feeling the pain. I feel like I could not take it anymore. I didn't even see the burying. They had to take me home. I could not take it.
Bum, 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 bum.
The cremation day. That was the day that was painful for me. I had to put on the machine myself, so it was painful. And I did not do it because I wanted to. It was something that he asked for. But I feel relief that his killers will be brought to justice. That they themselves sit back and ask themselves, why did they do that? Why did they have to take an innocent man's life? What did he do to them that caused them to have to reach that way to see taking his life would be the solution?
I have faith in God. And the Holy Spirit hold me there. It hold me. People will watch me and say, your children didn't die? I say, yes, my children died. But you die, so nobody to die for you? I say, well, I don't know. I don't know what holding me. I would tell him, have faith in God and have strength. Crying won't change it. Thinking too much about it won't change it. It happened already. You just have to have faith in God.
That voice keep coming in my head. And I thank God every day for him. Be strong. Stay strong. Stay focused. Do not lose your sanity. Stay strong. Think. 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 And that's all I've been doing. Call upon him. Call upon him. And that's all. Thank you, Lord, for what you put me through. Thanks for the weak, for the bad. Thanks for the good. And I appreciate it. I embrace it, Lord. Thank you. And that's all I keep saying. And I think that has been my strength, by accepting. Because when people say God only gives you good, he put you through tests. And my test, I don't know what it is, but it's yet to be known for me.
A 40-plus-years-old female was discovered face down near a pickup truck with multiple punctured wounds to her body. She was treated and transported to Victoria Hospital for further medical treatment.
Cheryl Clark was still mourning the death of her husband, who was shot and killed over 2 months ago. On that terrible Friday morning, Clark was playing the machines at the corner bar upstairs on Brazil Street when she was involved in an altercation, according to reports. Clark was on her way to her pickup van when gunmen opened fire on her.
Cheryl was a very nice girl to us in the yard. Very nice lady. Cheryl take care of the children. Cheryl do all kinds of things she could do for the children. And the person to take Cheryl's life, so that's really hurting.
Since I remember just after the demise of her husband, BJ, Cheryl and I were in conversation, and it really, really surprised me, you know, for her to have manifested that level of strength and forgiveness. Cheryl said that, boss, you would not believe, but I found it in my heart to forgive those persons who killed my husband. And her explanation essentially was that those persons who did it came from broken homes, and those persons came from homes that was devoid of love. And if we loved each other, then invariably you would not do that to somebody you love.
Sleep over my soul. Sleep over my soul. Though the road in life gets rough, just sleep over my soul.
In April last year, I married Cheryl and BJ. And even though BJ did not live to see or to celebrate his first anniversary, Cheryl celebrated it in full memory of her.
Me no know where them kill your father. No, me no know where them kill your father. But Jah knows.
Even after receiving 7 gunshot wounds, she was able to make it to the hospital. She was able to still tell her family that she loves them. She was able to still fight. The person or the people who would do such things obviously had not had a little chance with Cheryl back. Because had they done so, even the thought to do such things would have disappeared from their minds. Because God doesn't give us more than we can bear. He doesn't. And she knew that. And we need to appreciate our lives. We need to appreciate our family, our friends.
Has never been.